Siemi Mbote to all the Bantu families all over the world and to the dispersed and outcast of Isolele in the eastern and western hemisphere. May the spirit of Congo, the spirit of Tatanzambe, the set-apart spirit, come upon you. In Zephaniah 3 verse 10, we read that the suppliant, the worshipper of Akongo, of Tatanzambe, even the daughter of his dispersed, are found beyond the rivers of Cush. Cush being Sudan. So beyond the Sudan area, beyond the Kushite territory, beyond the Sudan, the supplier of Tatanzambe is found, the worshipper, and even the daughter of his dispersed. If you look at the map and you locate the Sudan area, which is the ancient Kush territories, when you locate that territory and beyond those rivers, you found a place called Congo. You will find the land of Congo in Central Africa. And the great creator has impressed his footmark in the soil of the land of Congo. Therefore, the land and its people are called by his name. Congo. Bakongo. Mukongo. Nzambe did not choose the people for the land itself. No, but the land for the people. He prepared that land special for the people. It's a rich land. It's a blessed land. And it has all the minerals, the oils, the metals, the stones. It's all found in that rich land that Tatanzambe blessed his people with.
Tuti mosika bayama tokatisa bambonge bibale Tatanzambe ya telemi poasala tokanga ekuke na Satan.
Yote si tozala kiloko makasi pona boboko tozala kanango awa tokomi oboma bondeko. Bendela Kongo ndezo kweya
Soboile loyo Mungu na kota Apanza fondation Totonga elongo Kongo ya lelo Yesengili sanga Topesa na maboko Totonga elongo.
Les autres, car l'amour supporte tout.
And Hebrew, a Greek, and Latin are found in the language of the Congo people, in all the Kikongo dialects. In Kikongo itself, in Kiluba, Kikuyu, Kiswahili, Lingala, and all the other Kikongo dialects, Hebrew, Greek, and Latin words are found. Now, I would like to quote out this book called The History of Luango, written by a French Jesuit. And I quote, "The idiom of Kakongo nearly the same with that of Luango. Now, Kakongo and Luango are both located in the Congos. Ngoyo, Samba, and other small circumjacent states differs essentially from that of Congo. Several similar articles and a great number of common roots seem, however, to indicate that these languages had a common origins, but they know not which of the two is the mother tongue. The clevers among the natives have not the smallest idea of the origin and progress of the language. They speak, say they, as they have heard their fathers speak. It has been thought that there might be perceived some marked connections between this language and some ancient tongues, especially the Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Though the missionaries, these are the Jesuit missionaries, in considering the richness and beauty of the language, suspected that it was formerly written in Geta. So, the missionaries and those who studied the people of the Congos, the peoples from the Mani Congo, the people from the Kakongo and Luango, those missionaries, they knew that these people were special. They knew that they had connection with the patriarchs, Isaka, Abana, Isaka, and Simba. And in their writings, they admit that Hebrew, Greek, and Latin is found in the languages, and they call it ancient tongues. All right. Now, let's read another article. Nevertheless, a belief persisted that one day the 10 lost tribes will be found. Eldad Hadani, for instance, a 9th century Jewish traveler, reported locating the tribes beyond the rivers of Abyssinia. Now, Abyssinia is an archaic word for Kush, Ethiopia, or Kush. And Kush, of course, is Sudan. Now, he said that he located the tribes, the 12 tribes, beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, the rivers of Kush. This Eldad Hadani was a philologist. And a philologist is someone who studies languages, yeah? Someone who is an expert in languages. And he identified the people beyond the rivers of Kush, whom he identifies as the 12 tribes, by the language, because he himself was a philologist. So by his skill set as a linguist, he knew to identify the 12 tribes of Isolele beyond the rivers of Kush. Now ask yourself, how are ancient Greek and Latin words found with the people beyond the rivers of Kush? And the Greek and Latin was considered by the Edomites as the language of the learned, the intellectuals and educated people. Now, the Greek language refers to the Macedonians and with Alexander the Macedonian, and the Latin to the Romans. So these Edomite nations, who in past time conquered the ancient world and forced our ancestors to abandon the laws of Nzambe and traditions of the Father, and to embrace the culture, gods, and religion of the Goyim. Neither was it lawful for a man to keep the Sabbath days or ancient feasts or to profess himself at all to be a Jew, to be Yahunde. Now, the heathen or the Ngoyi, the Bango, were always, even till today, threatened by our identity as the Benanzambe. And there is a clear history of them denying us our identity, our culture, our history, and even our God. And they mock the name of Nzambe, a Congo. In this age, when the black person, the Muntu, is striving as never before in modern history to learn about himself, we discover that the true culture of the Habiru, the Hebrew, is deeply rooted in the native soil of black sub-Sahara Africa. The Bantu ethnic group are the true Israelites of the book. Now, I want to let us read something out of the book entitled Hebrew Heritage of Black Africa. The prophet Isaiah, who lived at that time, prophesied that Nzambe shall set forth his hand a second time to recover the remnant of his people from Assyria and from Egypt and from Patros, southernmost Egypt, known as Nubia, and from Kush, now Ethiopia and the Sudan. See that? And the Sudan. Now notice that all these countries and territories that is mentioned, that are mentioned, are in African soil. Only 70 years later, another Hebrew prophet, Zephaniah, in Zephaniah 3 verse 10, was to say, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering. That an Israelite population already inhabiting the inland heart of black Africa is recorded by John Africanus, a famous 16th century geographer and historian. He records in his book, which in translation is entitled A Geographical History of Africa, there inhabited a most populous nation of Jewish stock, located west of the Nile, see, west of the Nile, going to the inner parts of Africa, Center Africa, and below the Sahara, west of the Nile, below the Sahara, in a region between Abyssinia, that is Ethiopia, and Congo. A glance at any modern map shows that the region, which Africanus says was inhabited by Jews at the time of Menelik, son of Solomon and the queen of Sheba, also Makeba, is almost precisely the Chet Nile area from where Dixon and other scholars inform us the parent stock of today's black Africans come, bringing with them the Hebrew Habiru customs of their forefathers, as we already have seen. At this point in our discussion, it might be worth noting that most historians agree that the early Israelites bear little, if any, resemblance to the white European Jews of today. You see, the true Israelites are black Africans. Now, I have a quote from A.J. Rogers, and I read, "Furthermore, we have no proof that the original 70 Jews, Israelites, who went to Egypt were white. According to their legends, they originated in Chaldea. And there is considerable evidence the inhabitants of that region in earliest times were Negroid. In fact, some writers say that the Jews, Israelites, were an African people. In other words, black people. Negroid people. Strabo said many of his time believed they were. Who was Strabo? Strabo was a Greek, a historian and philosopher. Now, when we go to the Zondervan Bible Dictionary and you look up Ham, this dictionary will tell you the following. Ham is the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes, but the Hamites, Cushites, Libyans, and Canaanites. See? So Ham is the progenitor of the dark races, but not the Negroes. You see? So who are the dark races? Who is this Zondervan Bible Dictionary referring as the dark races? The Hamites, the Cushites, the Libyans, and Canaanites. See? So the Hamites were black, the Cushites were black, Libyans were black, and Canaanites were black. And according to Herodotus, who also was a Greek historian and philosopher, these are the true Africans. He calls them the African nations. Yeah? He calls the Hamites, the Cushites, the Libyans, the Canaanites, African nations. Especially the Libyans and Hamites, you know, which are the Egyptians, and the Cushites. They are known to be black. Now, the Negroes are set apart because it said Ham, the progenitor of the dark races, but not the Negroes, not of the Negroes. So who are the Negroes? In the book of Acts 13, verse 1, an Israelite is called nigger. An Israelite is called nigger. The word negro comes from the Latin word niger of Niger, which means black. In 1555, this word gained popularity among the Spaniards and Portuguese, and they used it to describe the black African Jews, who were also known as Moreno, yeah, the Portuguese and the Spaniards. They took this word from its Latin origin and they began to call the black African Jew in Portugal and Spain negro, negro, yeah, and this word negro transformed into the English negro. And Negroes. Yeah? And these African Jews in Spain and Portugal, they were also known as Moreno. And Moreno is another Spanish word which means black. Moreno is the Spanish and Portuguese and Jewish nickname for people with dark hair and swartzy black complexion. Now, swartzy means black. It is German. And zwart in Dutch has the same meaning, black. Yeah? So they use the word Moreno, yeah, as a nickname, an insult for dark people, people with dark complexion and dark hair. And this word moreno, probably comes from the Latin maurinos, a derivative of classic Latin maurus, more, which means black. See, more come from the Latin maurus, which means black. So you have all these different names: Niger, Negro, Moreno, more. And they all mean the same. Black, 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 black. An interesting fact, Moreno is also a popular name in South Africa, mainly among the Sesotho boys. And the name means king or chief, and is usually given to boys of regal lineage. Christianity and Islam are not the faith or tradition of our ancestors, but of those who conquered us by the sword and forced their religion upon those whom they subdued. We are Muntu. We are Congo. We are Bananzambe. Christianity and Islam are not the faith and traditions of our forefathers, but they are the traditions and faith of those who conquered and subdued us and pushed their religion. So it's time to come out of those religions of the Ngoyi and embrace your true culture and faith. Let's serve the Elimo of our ancestors with a pure conscience. For Nzambe has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, before the Europeans came into West and Central Africa, and so into the Kingdom of Congo, our ancestors were already acknowledging the great Creator, the Supreme Being, the Most High, the King of all kings. The European did not introduce the concept of one Almighty God to our ancestors. Our ancestors knew already that they were just one who sits on the throne. The European did bring nothing new to our ancestors. They only brought destruction by deception. Allow me to read another quote out of this book, History of Luango. It is page 594. They acknowledge a supreme being who, having no origin, is himself the origin of all things. They believe he has created all that is fine, all that is good in the universe. That being by nature just, he loves justice in others and severely punishes fraud and perjury. They call him Nzambe. Notice that this book was written in 1776. The writer, this Jesuit, all of them, they knew who our ancestors were. And in the writings, they tell us that our ancestors, they already acknowledged a supreme being, one creator, one God above all, one who loves justice, who had created all things that is good in the universe. A God who loves justice, love and peace, who hates fraud and perjury. And they called his name Nzambe. And he was also called by the ancestors Akongo Sango, the father. Akongo Muana, the son. And Akongo Musenoke, the spirit. And this is not referring to the triune Godhead of Christianity. Yeah. Triune means consisting of three in one. See? That's what triune means, consisting of three in one. Nzambe is not three persons in one. He is not three persons in one. This is the greatest misconception and false doctrine of Christianity, that God is three persons in one. The Father is the supreme and the greatest. You can call him the ancient Koko who sits on the throne. Akongo Mwana is the Son, the messenger and mediator of the covenant. Akongo Musenoke is the spirit of life and the divine Koma. Koma. And they are all their own persons. See, they are all their own persons. And they exhibit their own unique character. The Son and the Spirit, they are in unison with the Father, the Most High. See, that's the reason it is said they are three who bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and they are one. Not saying that they are one person, but meaning that they are in unison with each other. It's like a group who agrees and say, okay, yes, let's do it. We are one. They are in unison with each other, in agreement with each other. One. In the country called the Gabon, near the Congo, there were black Jews known as the Bafumbu. Some writers called them by various names such as Mafambo, Mayomba, Mayumba, and Mafumbu. Now, dear brother of mine, Brother Faria, he is from the tribe of Yomba. He is a Mayomba. Now, this Abbe Poyart is the writer also from the book The History of Loango. A French writer, a French Jesuit, says that these Jews held the coast of Loango between the Congo River and Rio Muni in Gabon. In 1776, the country began about 60 miles from the coast and extended north from the Congo about 200 miles. In appearance, these black Jews, let me say that again. In appearance, these black Jews are hardly distinguishable from the other Africans, you see, because they are both black. It has been reported that these Jews practice some divination and magic like native Africans. Yeah, what the white man does not understand, he calls it magic, but it's actually spirituality. However, they observe some Jewish ceremonies and live in separate communities, not considering themselves native Africans. See, they are not considering themselves as Hamites, as Cushites, as Libyans. No, because they are from another stock. The villages of these Jews are situated along the Loango coast, for more than 100 miles, even south of the Congo River. South of the Congo River. Where do you go when you go south of the Congo River? You enter into the interiors of the Congo, as you can see on this map. You see the River of Congo, and when you go south of the River Congo, you enter into the interior of Congo. Good Bay writes that when they are interrogated in regard to the origin, some of these Jews said they migrated from the south, probably Angola, some from the north, probably Nigeria, some from other sides of the mountains, perhaps Ethiopia or Kush. Ethiopia is Kush, the areas of Sudan. Like the Portuguese Jews, the Bafumbo Jews were very active in commerce. Wait a minute, Portuguese Jews? Yes. You see, these Portuguese Jews are the Moreno, whom the Portuguese and the Spaniard called the Moreno and the Negro. And the Moor, from the Latin Maurus. These are those Portuguese Jews. Okay? Now, like the Portuguese Jews, the Bafumbo Jews were very active in commerce. Because why compare the Portuguese Jews with African Bafumbo Jews? No, because they are the same. They are the same people. The one came from Portugal and Spain, the other is from Africa, but they are the same. They have the same origin. When David Livingstone was in Africa, he discovered a settlement of educated blacks about the year 1847. This Livingstone discovered what? A settlement of educated blacks. Where did these educated blacks come from? Educated black Jews. That's what they must say. And most of them came from Portugal and Spain. They were located inland about 200 miles from the Luanda coast and are known as the Jews of Angola. The Jews of Angola, of Angola. These black Jews were active in commerce, eager to learn, and passed much knowledge of Portuguese history and law, and possessed much knowledge of Portuguese history and law. Why do you think? Because they came from Portugal. They were banished in 1419. They were banished from Portugal. Yeah? So, that's the reason. They possess much knowledge of Portuguese history and law. In their commercial enterprises, these Jews penetrated inland hundreds of miles from the coast and were known also as clerks and riders. See, as clerks and riders. Livingstone considered these Jews to be deportees from Portugal. You see? So, these Jews of Angola, these Jews who were black educated Jews, they were deportees from Portugal. King John II in 1492 expelled all the Jews to the island of St. Thomas, which had been discovered in 1471, and to other Portuguese settlements on the continent of Africa, now settlements like Angola, for example, and from these banished Jews, The black Portuguese, oh, here we have it again, banished Jews, deportees, the black Portuguese, as they are called, and the Jews in Luango. Now here we see again that the Portuguese, the black Portuguese, were Jews who were banished from Portugal. The black Portuguese were Jews who were banished from Portugal and Spain. And they settled in Africa. Why? Because they came originally from Africa. Alright, so the European Jesuits and the colonists did not introduce the Most High to the Bantu. And the Ngohi knew that they could not teach us God. They knew it. But as the serpent was the most subtle of all the beasts of the field, the European manifested the nature of their father, the serpent, and forced our ancestors. They forced us in Spain, in Portugal, in Europe, in Africa, when they came, to abandon our traditions, to forget about the laws of Nzambe, to forget about our own culture. Let's go and read the letter of King Leopold to the colonial missionaries. This letter was written in 1883. A year later, we know that there was this conference in Berlin. It was called the Berlin-Congo Conference. And the purpose of that conference in Berlin was to divide the kingdom of Congo. Not Africa, but the kingdom of Congo. Like it is written in the book, they have divided my lands. So judgment will come to those nations. Now let us read from this letter of King Leopold, who was a king from the Belgium. And this letter will reveal the evil of Christianity. Now, reverence, fathers and dear compatriots, the task that is given to fulfill is very delicate and requires much tact, strategy, and lies. You will go certainly to evangelize, yes, but your evangelization must inspire above all Belgium interest. You see, that's what evangelization is all about, bringing the gospel. He said, you go evangelize, but inspire above all Belgium interest. So when the missionaries came to enlighten the Africans with the gospel, they did not come to teach you about Nzambe. Let's continue. Your principal objective in our mission in the Congo is never to teach the niggers to know God. See? So the mission was never to teach the niggers to know God. Why? Because he says, as we continue, this they know already. This they know already. They speak and submit to a Mungu, one Nzambi. See? So even this wicked King Leopold of Belgium knew that our ancestors were already worshipping the one and true Elimo. They knew. That's the reason he is instructing these Jesuits, these missionaries, in this letter of 1883. before the Berlin-Congo Conference. Go to Congo, but don't teach the niggers how to know God because they already know Him. They call His name, they submit to one Nzambi. And listen to this part here. Have courage to admit it. You see? So put your pride aside. Just admit it. Those niggers, they know God. They know the Most High. Have courage to admit it. You are not going to teach them what they know already. So have courage. Put your pride aside. Because you are not going to teach them what they know already. Unbelievable. Your essential role is to facilitate the task of administrators and industrials, which means you will go to interpret the gospel in the way it will be the best to protect our interest in that part of the world. You see, so the gospel of the European, it has been designed and interpreted in a way that it will best protect their interest in those parts that they were preaching and teaching the good news. For these things, you have to keep watch on disinteresting our savages from the richness that is planting in their underground. To avoid that, they get interested in it and make you murderous competition and dream one day to overthrow you. Your knowledge of the gospel will allow you to find tax ordering and encouraging your followers to love poverty. Like happier are the poor because they will inherit the heaven. And it's very difficult for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. You have to detach from them and make them disrespect everything which gives courage to affront us. I make reference to the mystic system, mystic system, and the war fetish, what they call witchcraft, warfare protection, which they pretend not to want to abandon. And you must do everything in your power to make it disappear. You see? So, these Jesuits, when they came, they were focused to teach us to love poverty and to remove the spirit of warfare out of us. Not to fight them, the missionaries, devils. Man, it is difficult if you are still in Christianity. Difficult to accept. Evangelize the niggers so that they stay forever in submission to the white colonialists. You see? So the gospel, the evangelic gospel of the missionary was designed to submit the niggers to the white colonialists so they never revolt against us. The restraints they are undergoing, so they never revolt against the restraints they are undergoing. Recite every day, happy are those who are weeping because the kingdom of God is for them. Why? Because they were beating us. They were killing us. And then the Jesuit priest will come in and recite, happy are those who are weeping because the kingdom of God is for them. You see how wicked this is, brothers and sisters. See how wicked. And make sure that niggers never become rich. Sing every day that it is impossible for the rich to enter heaven. See, man, we were being fed lies by the Jesuit priest. Teach the niggas to forget their heroes and to adore only ours. You see? That's the reason, even till today, Negroes, Africans, Habiru, Israelites in Africa know nothing about their own heroes, but they know a bunch of things about the heroes of the Mundele. Those Africans who voluntarily converted to Christianity before the colonial conquest, such as Afonso I of the Bakongo, he was the king, in the 15th century, probably did not discern the purpose of the brand of Christianity that was supplied to them, which was probably why they fell easy prey to the missionaries and the white traders and pirates who followed them. See, the king did not discern. He did not discern. My goodness. The African captives who were taken abroad and enslaved, and the Africans at home, after the European conquest, having already been forcibly deprived of their autonomy, were in no political position to resist Christianization. Thus, the Christianity still practiced in all of the African American diaspora, just as that in the African homeland since the start of the 20th century, continues to carry out the Leopoldian mandate. You see, so our people are still suffering the mental slavery of this Leopoldian mandate. Insane. Christianity is the invention of the devil. You see, and when the European brought Christianity by this mandate of Leopold to the Congos and to Africa, it had one purpose: to subdue the Africans, to subdue, and this gospel served the interest of the colonizers. It was not meant to teach you about Katanzambe, but to subdue you spiritually, mentally, so that they can rule over you physically. I am done with this message. So, Isolele, remember, we are living in the time of restitutions. Let us return to Katanzambe. Let us awake out of the dust and receive the spirit of life, the spirit of Katanzambe. Let us remember the law of Massa and our ancestors. I am Nabi Kefa, and I bless you in Geta.